Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here in the Philippines. Yes, how are you guys doing? Hope everybody's doing all right. Welcome to the Church of the Firstborn. You know, as the Lord has told me a while back to do a YouTube church way back. I made videos about it, haven't really, you know, just keeping it casual. Intend on still keeping it casual, you know, not anything official. May start another website or something like that. Or, as a matter of fact, there's a young brother who's working on a website. But he's still working on it. I'm waiting to hear from him as we're going to try to put it together for the church. And there's a sister who said she wanted to do the, from California, who wants to do like the secretary of the channel, whatever, to maintain the website. So please pray about that. Church of the Firstborn, the Lord has mentioned to me again 3 or 4 times to go forward with it. I don't know what all that means or what, but God bless you guys. Anyway, I want to read a verse to you, Ephesians 4:14, that we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive. That's why God put me on YouTube, brothers and sisters, and that's why the Lord has led me to start Joshua's ministry, and why the Lord led me to start the Church of the Firstborn from the dead. The Lord Jesus Christ is also known as the Firstborn from the dead, the Bible says. Now that name, I have no idea why the Lord gave me that name. I guess I can just say right now off the top of my head that he's talking about the resurrection. He's the Firstborn from the dead. You know, the resurrection. And of course, the resurrection is referring to the rapture of the church. So praise God. That's what this ministry is all about. We're looking for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ to catch away his church. The Latin word is similar to rapture. That's where we get the word rapture from the Greek word harpozo. Latin word base comes up with rapture in English. And the word is in the King James is to be caught up to meet the Lord in the air. Anyway, brothers and sisters, we have a final mission to do before the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. I want to talk to you about that again today. And just again, I thank all those people who have ordered the book. I've signed copies of it. And the theme about the book is our final mission. Really, the main point of the book is our final mission that we have to finish up this church age, the age of the Gentiles. The Lord is really speaking to me lots of different things. But as an example, today, what I wanted to talk to you about, and I may, anyone who's been following my channel, and I've made many videos about duality, about the duality of man, the duality of the United States. As an example, quick review, the United States is the number one producer of pornography in the world. Yet, at the same time, the number one producer of Bibles, missionaries, funding for, you know, donations, all kinds of stuff for Christian activities. So the United States has a duality. Well, man also has a duality, okay? Mankind is in a duality as individuals. And so as an example, I've made several videos on this, but the Lord was just kind of showing me from a different angle today. So in Romans chapter 8, it says, those who are led by the Spirit, these are the sons of God, to be led by the Spirit of God. Now what happens is, okay, you know, I was thinking about the duality of it today. The Lord has had me on that theme and showing me stuff. You know, and let me see where to begin. You know, my videos are long, but it's for those who desire meat. For those who want to go to the deep end of the pool. You know, I try to lay all that stuff out there for people that are not Christians, of course, people that are new to the faith. Then you've got those people that are perpetually, you know, on baby milk. You know, they're perpetually on baby milk. They perpetually want to stay on the shallow end of the pool. And as a sister from Texas reminded me the other day, one time I said that, you know, us people that want the meat, you know, we're lactose intolerant. You know, we're tired of the baby milk. Like it says in, you know, Hebrews chapter 6, you know, let's don't lay again the foundation of our faith. We know about salvation. You know, we know about water baptism. We know all those things. Let's don't relay the foundation of our faith. Let's move on to the sincere meat of the word. Okay, so let's do that. And anyway, what happens is just let's look at some dualities here. Let's begin with what the Lord showed me today. When I was walking or when I went to do my, I run three times a week, and I went to run in one of my, the normal place where I run, and this along the places where I run is the places too where at Christmas time I go out and give, you know, the flip-flops for the kids, I give chocolates, I would give candies and all kinds of stuff all along the way and different things that people need. Like there's a girl, she just started college, and I've been living in this place for 5 or 6 years, and so, but in this particular place 4 or 5 years, and so, you know, I've seen her since when she started high school, and she doesn't have a dad and stuff. Dad's already dead. She's the youngest of many kids, and you know, so I want to give her something. She's just started college this year, and you know, her relatives are all fishermen. Their family is a family of fishermen and coconut farmers. Anyway, so always it's in one little area. It's lots of different areas. So anyway, after I was going by one of these, this area, there's this, you know, along the routes that I go, I know the dogs who you have to rebuke in Jesus' name. There's lots of dogs that won't say anything. They don't move. They don't bother you. There's always that one in some place that's really trying to get berserk and try to, like, they're going to bite you. And I just rebuke them in Jesus' name, and they stop. So there's this one place with this dog, and the dog's name is the King. As a matter of fact, the dog's name is the King, but Filipinos say, the King, the King. So anyway, there's this dog, the King, and he's always, I mean, I've been running past the same place for like 4 or 5 years. And he always gets berserk, and I always rebuke him in the name of Jesus, and he won't, you know, he stops. He doesn't come near me. It's, you know, it's a good exercise of faith. You should try it next time. To you know, rebuke like a dog in Jesus' name, and that they would stop and leave you alone. And by the grace of God, you know, there's power in all things in Christ. So every knee shall bow to the name of Jesus, even dogs, cats, whatever, wild animals. So anyhow, today when I went by there, the King wasn't there in his place, and I went on around the corner there. It's in this farming area. There's lots of these little fields, and you know, there's some of those people are people who we got some of the orphans from and different stuff over the years. And lots of those farmers, their farmland's been taken for a mall and stuff, you know. And I'm trying to help those guys relocate. I got 1,000 different things that the Lord is using me to try to do for him. It's an example. So anyway, as I was, you know, I can make videos about all that stuff. But anyway, as I was running around there, I'll say a few hundred yards from the house of the King, there he was. He was in the middle of the little trail. It's like a little, whatever you call it, just a little trail, it's not a road, amongst this farmland. And there he was, but he did not bark. He put his tail between his legs and he ran back home to his place. He didn't say a word. And so I was like, well, I wonder what's wrong with the King, you know? And then, you know, the Lord spoke to me and said, oh, he's out of his territory. He's not in his territory. He's over here. And I was like, yeah, that's right, Lord, he's not in his territory. Then, you know, dogs only, you know, that's the way of dogs. I said, in my head, you know, that's the way of dogs. They're only worried about defending their own territory. If they're outside their territory, they're, you know, they got their tail between their legs. They're meek. They're in some other dog's territory or whatever, you know. So they defend their territory. And then as soon as I said that, the Lord spoke to me and said, no, it's not only the way of dogs, it's the way of the world. It's the way of the flesh. It's the way of the world and the way of the flesh to defend your own territory. So that's one part of duality I wanted to talk to you about. The other part, let me get into this. I really want to look at three things here. Or how people would miss the mark with walking in the Spirit. So the Bible says, you know, in Romans chapter 8, it's already mentioned, it says, those who are led by the Spirit, these are the sons of God, Romans 8:16. And also in the beginning of that, it talks about, you know, there's no condemnation to those who walk according to the Spirit and not according to the flesh. Now in that text, to be biblically and theologically correct, it's talking about trying to follow the law versus trying to walk by grace through faith. Okay, that's what the text is actually saying. But it's also true that if we walk after a sinful nature and living in sin, as in Galatians chapter 5, it talks about the fruit of the flesh and then the fruit of the Spirit. And Galatians 5, 22 and 23 is the fruit of the Spirit, and then the flesh is just right before, right after that, whatever, in the Galatians chapter 5. So there's walking after the Spirit and after the flesh. So that's the thing the Lord began to talk to me about. And then there's another thing the Lord began to show me. I don't want to forget. That's why I keep mentioning it, about people trying to walk after the wrong spirit, or after their own spirit and not after the Spirit of the Lord. So this, like with a dog or with a human, like if we're walking according as a beast or in our flesh, We're worried about defending our territory. We act like a brute beast, like an animal in our carnal flesh. You know, we don't turn the other cheek. As Jesus said, you've heard it's been said, you know, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say unto you, one who strikes you on one cheek, turn to him the other. Turn the other cheek. Love your neighbor as yourself. This is not the way of a beast, but the way of God. Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount there, after he said all those things, and Matthew 5, 6, and 7, he says, be ye therefore perfect, as your heavenly Father is perfect. Jesus set the standard way up here, way above the law. The law is following a list of rules. You know, tithe, boom. Jesus said it's not about tithing. It's about, you know, it talks about in the New Testament, you give with a, God loves a cheerful giver. It's not about giving, but giving cheerfully. Jesus said by the same measure you use, it'll be measured back to you. Now, of course, and I've said this many times as a disclaimer, we are not under the law, we are not required to tithe. But Jesus said, by the same measure you use, it'll be measured back to you. You know, he who sows sparingly will reap sparingly. Lots of people have a problem with money. Money is their God. It's a big thing for people to give up. And I'll tell you the reason. One reason why the Lord has blessed me to do this ministry and to serve him for the last 13 years is because money is not my God. You can never outgive God. I'm not afraid to give. I walk by faith and I know God will provide. And give as the Lord leads, to love your neighbor as yourself. Like all the people I help here in the Philippines, you know, I've been doing it out of my own means until we started Joshua's ministry in August 2012 when my stepson there died. They're on the wall. Look at the right, it's backwards on the computer screen. Joshua back there. I was going to talk about him too, about power of the blood. Power in the blood. It's been a year and a half, and I wanted to do a message about it a long time ago, but I haven't been able to. But I think now I'm able to do a message about power in the blood and the story of Joshua, my stepson. By the grace of God, if I remember, maybe I'll make it today or tomorrow or next time. Anyhow, so we can operate in our flesh like a dog does, or we can operate in the way the world does and protect our territory, or we can, you know, allow people into our territory. It's not, you know, it's to suffer little children to come unto you, to, you know, love your neighbor as yourself, all those things that Christ talked about. So I want to talk about something else. Let's take it to another level. There's lots of people that walk according to their own spirit. The Bible says, you know, that the human heart is wicked, desperately wicked. Who can understand it? I think that's in Jeremiah. The human heart is wicked, desperately wicked, and who can understand it? You know, it's deceitful, it says, the human heart. Now, but the Bible says also that the spirit of a man is the candle of the Lord. So when we become born again, regenerate, what does that mean? We become spiritually born. Our spirit man becomes new. Now, we still have our flesh nature, and no, we're not half fallen angel. Those who take the mark may become some kind of beast. They will become some kind of beast or freak, no longer a regular person. But we as a Christian, we have our spirit becomes alive to God through the rebirth, spiritual rebirth, but our flesh is still the flesh. We still wrestle against our own flesh. We fight the good fight of faith to overcome our own flesh, as Paul's talking about, dying daily. We still have a sin nature in our flesh. That's why we have to crucify the flesh, starve the flesh, feed the spirit. Can you imagine if you only eat once a week? How healthy would you be if you only eat once a week? Well, when people, you know, go to church or praise the Lord, read the Bible, or watch a YouTube video like mine, you know, that's when you're eating spiritually. So lots of people, they're feeding their flesh. If I sit around watching porno all day, I'm just only a human. If I sit around watching porno all day, I mean, it's going to affect me. You know, garbage in, garbage out. It's going to affect me. You know, it's going to, you know, change you and make you, you know, whatever. It's going to make you commit adultery or whatever. It's going to affect you. I don't care who you are. That's why we don't look at those things, because it has an effect on us. Get in drinking. You know, if you start drinking every day, you're going to become, you know, eventually you're going to become addicted, smoking, whatever. So, I mean, we still have our flesh nature to deal with. But there are people who try to walk in the power of their own human spirit, spiritualism, like Oprah Winfrey, all this New Age stuff. She's spiritual, you know, she's spiritual. So there's a fine line. That's where people get mixed up. Now, I know that our brother Jason Egroff, I think is how you pronounce his last name, who does the Revelation News, he had mentioned a video like this. I made lots on duality. He and I have talked about it even on his radio show, and he did a YouTube video about just duality, and he was talking about dealing with New Age people. There is a subtle line between Christianity and spirituality. So this is an example that the Lord gave me that's pretty wild. Just this afternoon, or just this evening, it's like 9 o'clock at night here. But anyhow, there is an old, my older brother used to have this video by Pink Floyd. My older brother is not a Christian. He loves all this. He loves Ziggy Stardust, which is David Bowie, who I've always despised David Bowie because he's so effeminate, you know, and come to find out, you know, him and Mick Jagger. Mick Jagger's wife divorced him because of his affair with David Bowie. She caught them together, you know. Anyway, you know, they're just sick. It's his alter ego, his demon-possessed name is... I mentioned all this stuff in the book that I wrote. Ziggy Stardust is his altered ego. Just like Slim Shady is Eminem's altered ego. Even Garth Brooks had an alter ego. It's his demon possession that comes on them. Sasha Fierce is the alter ego, demon-possessed spirit that comes upon, what's her name? The wife of a famous, what's her name? It's slipping my mind. I don't know all these people that well, but she sang lots of songs. What's her name? Crazy in Love. Sasha Fierce is the persona of a, what is her name? I can't slip in my mind. I can't think right now. Anyway, I can see her in my mind right now. Anyhow, so people are trying to follow after their own human spirit. As an example, anyway, this Pink Floyd group that I was trying to talk about, and I just got into all that other information. Sister Rosemary has still got about 1,000 books in her garage, and I think I've got about 100 or so left that I've signed, maybe 200 left. And so that's why she's asked me several times, you know, to make sure I mention the book, because every time I do, we sell some. So maybe if I mention it 100 times, she can clean out her garage, brothers and sisters. Help me clean out Rosemary's garage. Under here is a link to buy the book that the Lord gave me. You know, I'm a missionary in the Philippines, and lots of times, just like when I went to the States, everybody thinks, oh, is a missionary he's going to raise money for the missions? No. God sent me to bring revival to the United States, to call the United States to repentance. Anyhow, and that's what I wrote the book about. Not about the missionary work, not about the orphanage and all those things we do here, but a call to revival, final boarding call, Satan's plan for the ages, and our last mission. Thank you, brothers and sisters, for your patience that I mentioned the book, because the proceeds are for the orphanage. That is true. Anyway, brothers and sisters, the Pink Floyd video, my brother used to have this called The Wall, Pink Floyd, The Wall. And then there is a famous song they used to play all the time when I was like 12 or 13 with the skating rink. I used to go to the skating rink for about a year there in junior high school and try to, you know, meet girls. When I first got interested in girls, maybe 13 or 14 or something. And anyhow, they had this song called Another Brick in the Wall. Another Brick in the Wall. And so there's a video to that. And then if you see the video and look at it, what it's, you know, it's really, in a way it sounds right. Because it's saying, hey, you know, the school is indoctrinating kids with the man's indoctrination to make them a drone, another brick in the wall for the man. And that's true. From a Christian perspective, especially now in these last days in New World Order, that's true. But now Pink Floyd made that song as a rebellion against the establishment. In this case, when you talk to these New Age people, to these old, you know, these old hippies and they don't know what to do, these old hippies, these old tree huggers, they see the establishment as Judeo-Christianity. They see the establishment as Christianity. You know, and all this kind of stuff. And what is good about America, they see that as what's bad. It's the opposite. But, you know, their end result, their desire is to be free. But they want to be free to wallow in the lust of their flesh. They want to be free to have orgies in the middle of the road. You know, like the Beatles, why don't we do it in the road? That's what they want. Just like in San Francisco just last year, that, you know, it's legal to walk around San Francisco naked. Now, it was about last year, of course, in the Castro District, which is the homosexual area. You know, they're all walking around naked, and they were having these protests because they were going to try to make it illegal. Because there's children, even though there's not many, because most of them are a bunch of homosexuals, but there are a few children in San Francisco. And then some of the parents were like, hey, all these naked men, a bunch of old, lustful, demon-possessed homosexuals walking around, naked in front of people's kids, and it's unacceptable. So they had a big going on and on and on about it, and finally they made some rule that for hygiene reasons they need to, like, you have to have a towel when you sit down in a restaurant or in a public place. You have to sit on a towel for hygiene purposes or something. Like, that's about all that came out of it, you know. So that was like last year in San Francisco. So these people have a spiritual thing they're looking for, just like the people here in the Philippines that go to the witch doctor I talked about the other day in spiritual warfare, like about the landlord I have here. They're looking for spiritual power, and so they're going to the wrong source. They're going to the devil. And as I've said in the video the other day, the biggest problem is the church has a form of godliness but denies the power thereof. Just like these hippies, what are they looking at? They're looking at these old mainline denominations. They're looking at these, you know, like your I'll just say it, Baptist, you know. They're looking at the Bible thumping self-righteous Baptist groups. They're looking at the, you know, these old mainline denominations, and they're looking at all the pedophile priests and all this stuff in the Catholic Church, because they don't think about idolatry and all that kind of stuff. And they're seeing that the system, you know, the establishment is Judeo-Christianity that's being used by the man to control the masses. There's truth with that. There is truth to that. That's why we real spirit-filled Christians need to, you know, confess that and say it. Look, when they had Katrina hurricane in 2005, it made the news. It came out afterwards, even though, like, Alex Jones had been talking about it before, that they have, what is it, 500,000, I think it is, or 50,000 or 500,000, whatever it is, pastors enrolled in a program with the government to spy on their congregations, report on their congregations, tell their churches to submit to the government and martial law. Using Romans 13, twisted by the government. This was under President Bush and continued under President Obama. I'm tired of everybody keep blaming this Obama. Am I an Obama supporter? No. Am I a Democrat? No. I am a conservative or libertarian. You know, if I was going to vote, you know, if there was a good candidate, it's 99%. It would probably be on the Republican side or independent if they had one. So, of course, I'm not a supporter of President Obama. But President Obama is only the next brick in the wall. He's only the next puppet on a string, and under the control of the powers that be, the Illuminati, a.k.a. the devil's people, the powers that be, the man. So all these things have been going on for a long time. It's been building up to this since, as they say, President Kennedy, even though, you know, by today's standard, President Kennedy, John F. Kennedy, was a conservative compared to today's standard. And no, he wasn't the greatest president in the world. But what got him killed is, A, he printed his own money, like Lincoln did. That's what got him killed. And B, he told the military-industrial complex and all those guys and the CIA, hey, you're not running things, I'm running things. He was going to dismantle the CIA, and he printed his own money, bypassing the Federal Reserve System. That's what got him killed. Same thing happened to Abraham Lincoln, making greenbacks, they called it, during the Civil War, interest-free money, as should be. That's what got him assassinated. Go research that in true history, and you'll find out what really going on in the world. Anyway, brothers and sisters, so I got into some politics there, but you know, we have to go where the Lord leads us. What's going on now in the New World Order? Not this flippant breaking news, it's the end of the world, the comet ISO is going to be something, breaking news, breaking news, breaking news, every little thing is breaking, breaking, breaking news. A mile wide and 1 inch deep water. Brothers and sisters, you got to go to the meat of things. You want to find out what's going on, you got to understand the foundational truths of God, the foundational truths of the Word, the foundational truth about history, about the history of the United States, the duality, what I'm talking about. The United States was founded by all these Masons. Washington, D.C. was laid out in all this satanic stuff, blah, blah, blah. But yet again, originally, the United States was founded by what? What do they call them? The Pilgrims. What does that mean to be a pilgrim? Children, what does that mean? Of the vast majority of people, especially younger people, it's really true, don't have any kind of vocabulary, no kind of education. We watch too much television. The word pilgrim, they were religious pilgrims. They came to the United States for religious freedom. The United States was originally founded by the European settlers for religious freedom. Freedom of religion, separation of church and state. That's where really what founded America. But yet on the other hand, yes, the founding fathers, almost all of them were Masons. They were illuminated people. They were Renaissance people. They were into all this kind of stuff. And Benjamin Franklin was in the hellfire Club. Go look that up. All kinds of stuff. They found these skeletons under his house, too, there when he lived in England, when he was the ambassador to England, when he was also in the Hellfire Club. Go look up some of those things you want to know about real American history. But there is a duality there, brothers and sisters. There's a duality of the United States. There's a duality of human nature. And I got into all this kind of side issues, okay? I'm not really preaching, kind of teaching, because the Lord is talking to me about preaching something different. So I'm teaching. So excuse me. But you have to choose, you know, starve the flesh, feed the spirit. Starve your flesh, feed your spirit. And don't follow the new age spiritual, your own spirit. But when you are born again and you're spirit filled, just like speaking in tongues, on it says, out of your belly would flow rivers of living water. Out of your belly, John chapter 7. It says in Acts chapter 2, they began to speak in tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Was God doing the speaking? No. They were doing the speaking as the Spirit gave them utterance. So we have to work with God. So in other words, His Spirit, as it says in Romans 8:14, His Spirit bears witness with our spirit that we're children of God. What am I saying? I'm trying to say when you're a Spirit-filled, born-again believer, you do trust your spirit. God's Spirit speaks through your spirit and leads you by your spirit. His Spirit leads your spirit. But those who are unregenerated are those who are... Actually, there's tons of people that say they're Christian, but they're not. It's what you call it. As John Wesley called it, mental assent. They agree in their mind that they're saved. It's all intellectual. It's not down here, but it's all here. Those people are trying to be led by their spirit, but it's not. It's their mind. They're being led by their sinful nature. And then the New Age people are being led. Their spirit is being led by a demonic spirit, lying spirits, all this other kind of stuff. How do we check that it's the Spirit of God? What does the Bible tell us? That's a big problem. People don't know the Word of God. It says to try and test every spirit. If it's saying Jesus Christ is Lord, then we know it's no one can say Jesus Christ is Lord except for by the power of the Holy Spirit. So we know it's coming from God. If what you feel the Lord is leading you to do is unbiblical, then it is not from God. That's why we need to know the Word of God. We need the Spirit and the Word. The Spirit and the Word to guide us, lead us. If God, as an example, God told me to go out here, oh, go do some drugs and get high, and then I'm going to talk to you. No, that's not God. Oh, go divorce your husband or wife or whatever. No, God's not going to tell you to do that. Even though people do sin, they do all kinds of sin. They get high, they get divorced. God didn't tell them to do that. That's what their own idea to do that. Okay, so we have to be led by the Spirit and the Word. That's where I'm trying to break this down, a practical application. You must be led by the Spirit and the Word. So you must study the Word, the New Testament specifically, particularly. We are led by the Word of God. God uses, you know, the Old Testament is part of the Word. That's true. Half the people on YouTube are reading those Old Testament prophecies and trying to apply it to their what's going on today in their own life and trying to apply all this stuff. You have to be a doctor of theology of Old Testament and Middle Eastern ancient history and all this stuff to understand what you're talking about. All that stuff had a literal meaning in those days in their time, and then there's different spiritual meanings. It's all interconnected. And that's why the Lord gave us the New Testament, the Gospels, and the Epistles. And the Epistles, the letters that the apostles wrote, lay out all kinds of details for the carnal-minded baby Christians to explain to them all kinds of little things that if they were spirit-filled, spirit-led Christians, they would know by knowing the foundational truths of God. That's what I'm on the internet for, brothers and sisters. That's why God put me on here for this ministry, for the Church of the Firstborn, for Joshua's ministry, for you guys who would watch my videos, not to get into all this little practical application so much. And that's what people want. People always ask me a practical application question. But the information I'm giving you is foundational truths of the nature of God, the Word of God, the Spirit of God. And from that, you can develop your own understanding of, according to the nature and will of God, what does God want me to do? I know God says A, B, C, D. So based on A, B, C, D, what should I do? Not, but Brother Patrick or Pastor Patrick, what you people call me. Some people call me Pastor Patrick. Some people call me Brother Patrick. What should I do? What should I do? But my job as a mentor in Christ is to mentor you to grow, to disciple, to grow in Christ. not to be tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine, as the text I read, Ephesians 4:14. Not to be on the milk all the time, but to say, I know that the word says A, B, C, D. So it's connecting that I should do E, not F, but E, because A, B, C, D, the foundational truth of the Word of God. And the Bible also says, as an example, let the peace of God rule your heart and mind through Christ Jesus. So you have peace in your heart when you're in God's will also. You have a peace from God when you're in His will. If you have, you know, there's also that feeling of lack of peace, lack of rest, something's wrong, an urgency, that something is not right. It's leading you to, hey, let me examine this situation. What am I doing? What am I doing wrong? Brothers and sisters, I am here to answer your questions. Do not get me wrong. I will say that for those who might misunderstand what I'm trying to say. I'm here for you. I'm going to answer your questions. I'm not going to give you canned answers. This is not a business. This is the greatest privilege in the world to do the work of the Lord, whether it be to give a word, to prophesy for the Lord, to pastor someone, minister to someone, answer the question. It's the greatest privilege in the world to serve the Lord God Almighty. But the goal of that, as they say, you know, just I guess a good example is when they say, you know, teach a man to fish, he'll fish for a day or for a lifetime. You know, give him a fish, he'll eat today. Teach him how to fish, he'll fish for a lifetime. It's like that. By the grace of God, I want to help all of you brothers and sisters learn how to fish yourself. Learn how to bear your own fruit and make your own harvest. That's the job of a pastor. And I guess that's the reason why all these churches, you know how many hundred people message me. My church has never talked on the end times. My church has never talked about revival. My church has never used the word repentance. The church I came out of never used the word repentance or sin. And the Lord, you know, prompted me and grieved me in my spirit every time I went because of that. Just, they want to keep people perpetually on the old, I guess it's not a bad word, I guess maybe it is. They want you on the udder. They want you on the udder. They want to keep giving you that baby milk. So they're in charge and they've got control. They're building their own kingdom and not the Lord's. But those whom the Son sets free are free indeed. That's what my channel's all about, to set you free. To help you get free, to help you walk in the full stature, as it says in Ephesians chapter 4, to the perfecting of the saints, till we become, you know, mature, one new man, a mature stature of the church, to help the church grow up. And most of the preachers that you see, I'm talking about pastors in churches and real pastors, not all these people on YouTube. I'm talking about, you know, you go to talk about, you know, your regular organized churches. They're building their own kingdom and they won't keep people on baby milk. So they're dependent on them. I don't want you dependent on me. I want you to be able to put two and two together and come up with four, not come up with five. Don't come up with three. Come up with four. And I want to equip you by the Spirit of the living God to do that. So that's what this ministry is all about. That's what the Lord has led me to make this video. Now I just realized it. It's the church of the firstborn among many brethren, that you're going to be resurrected, that you're going to be raptured, that you're going to be rapture ready, that you're going to be a fisher of men, that you are going to be fully equipped and empowered by God, by His Spirit and by His Word to do His will. Now that's why, I've been steadily getting more aggressive as the Lord is leading me. You must be baptized in the Holy Spirit. It says in Acts chapter 2, Peter said, you know, repent, verse 38, repent and be baptized every one of you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. It's not for you only, but all those abroad, as many as the Lord your God has called. I didn't say the exact words there, but it's for as many as the Lord our God has called. Now, God calls people to salvation, and if you're called to salvation, you're called to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. All Christians need to receive power from on high, that they might be a witness for the Lord, Acts chapter 1. So I'm not going to compromise on that. I'm not going to back down. I'm not going to say, no, you don't need to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. That's not true. If we didn't need it, God wouldn't give it to us. Jesus said, I send you another comforter. And that words there in the Greek, it's saying the Holy Spirit is equal to Jesus. That's some of the reasons why we have the doctrine of the Trinity and all that, is because Jesus said, I'll send you another comforter. Another comforter. The Holy Spirit. Jesus talks on and on about it there John chapter 14, 15, 16, 17, all that during the Last Supper. Jesus talks a lot about the Holy Spirit, another comforter. He was a comforter. The Holy Spirit is another comforter. We need the Holy Spirit. If we didn't need it, like I said, God wouldn't have gave it to us. God doesn't give us something that we don't need. God gives us exactly what we need. He doesn't give us, the spiritual power that He gives us. We need the spiritual power. He doesn't give you more than you need. He gives us what we need, when we need it. And you need it. You need it to be a witness. When all the people in the whole world is born again Christian, then you don't need the Holy Spirit anymore. When the Lord has returned, you don't need the Holy Spirit power anymore. In the millennial reign of Christ, you won't need it anymore. All those things will have passed away, as it talks about. You'll be known as you are known. All that happens when the Lord returns, when that which is perfect has come, the millennial reign of Christ. And until that day, we all need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Brothers and sisters, I've been going on and on, as you know how I am. I'm going to go ahead and cut this video off. The Lord spoke to me just a few minutes ago. He's been speaking to me several things about the breakthrough for Joshua's ministry. Now, I've got invitations to go to places all over the world. This came at one time. Some India, several different nations in Africa, some nations, other parts of the world, South America, different places, all at the same time, involving some of them are for revivals. Some of them are for orphanages. I ask you to pray about that, please. If you're still watching this video, obviously, you're a follower of Joshua's ministry. Thank you all. I ask for your prayers. The Church of God in southern India is inviting me to do revivals there. I don't know if I'll go. I need to pray about it because I kind of got my hands full here in the Philippines. But I know that the Lord spoke to me when I started Joshua's ministry that we go international. It's already international between the United States and the Philippines. And then, of course, there's viewers all around the world who watch these videos from, I think, 120-something countries have watched the videos I've made. So praise God for the YouTube. It's another duality, right? YouTube has got lots of evil stuff, wacky stuff, and then the Internet's full of pornography. America is the number one producer of Internet pornography. But yet, here I'm on here preaching. Most of your preachers on YouTube are American. So praise God. Praise God. For the good things from America. And not just talk about the bad stuff all the time. God bless you guys. Love you guys. Please pray for these things. I got some serious preaching to do that the Lord laid on me. About the blood of Jesus Christ. Some more. Praise the Lord for the blood of Jesus. There is power in the blood. The Bible says, and God said in the Old Testament, that the power of life and death is in the blood. That's why we're not supposed to drink blood. That is something that the Gentile Christians are supposed to follow. Acts chapter 15, we're not supposed to drink blood of animals. That is one thing that they gave us. Do not eat animals that's been strangled. Do not commit sexual immorality or fornication is what it says. Do not eat animal sacrifice to idols and don't drink blood. That's the commandments for the Gentile church given to us by the apostles when they met in Jerusalem in Acts chapter 15. That is the part of the law that we are told to follow, and that's it. So I would just mention this about fornication in that case. Fornication is all sex besides marital sex. So adultery in itself is sex with a married person and you're not married to them. If you're married or someone, the other person is married and you're not and you have some kind of a sexual relationship, that is adultery. But it's also under fornication. Fornication covers that too. Adultery is a specific type of fornication. But all, sex between two men, even, homosexuality is still, sodomy and all, it's still part of fornication. Any kind of sex outside of the marriage bed is fornication. Between anybody. So when it says sex, in the NIV it'll say sexual immorality, sexual fornication. It's including all those things. All those things. Anyway, God bless you guys. Love you guys. Just continue to pray for us here. We have the victory pressing through. Been very busy with Joshua's ministry, as you saw the video I posted of the. We already distributed about I think 3 of the 4 boxes. Got one left. I'm holding in reserve. Gonna distribute that one. We're having a party for the kids on December 21st, this coming Saturday. I'm going to make a video there. I'll be posting that. Lots of new pictures from that. And I got to figure out, you know, how I'm going to, this boxes we got is just not enough, guys. I mean, that's the thing that always bothers me about doing the boxes. I mean, it's like, I need a million boxes. It's just never enough. It's just enough to, you know, it's just like if you're starving to death and someone gives you, you know, a couple of bites of your favorite food, it's like, it's just enough to make you mad. You know what I'm saying? It's just whet your appetite. God bless you guys. I'm already 40 minutes. I'll talk to you guys later.